Welcome to lecture 17. My name is Professor J. N. Mandal, Department of Civil Engineering, Indian Institute of Technology, Mumbai, India. The name of the course, Geosynthetics Engineering in Theory and Practice. Now, this module 4, lecture 17, Geosynthetics for Filtration, Drainage and Erosion Control System. Now, I will explain the recap of the previous lecture, the design for the filtration, geosynthetics behind the retaining wall, geosynthetics filter around underdrain in highway, and installation procedure of geosynthetics in underdrain. I have also given many examples for the use of geosynthetics behind the retaining wall or highway and so on. Next, we will discuss geosynthetic sealed fences and sealed curtain, that is Task 25 Report 1990, Page WA 1985, Christopher and Holtz 1985. Geosynthetics non-oven or oven can be used as seal fence or seal curtain placed within downward slope, runoff water, ditches, lake, etc. The geosynthetics is placed vertically on the post. The role of geosynthetics is to retain maximum amount of suspended particle and allow the water to pass through the curtain without any clogging or blinding. For the seal fences or seal curtain, the selection of geosynthetics generally depend on the gradation of the fine grain soil. For example, if this is like a curtain and these are the posts and this is the geosynthetics material. And these are the posts. And like this, this is the what I can say that hillside wash. Or any construction site where there is a slope and all the precipitation to this slope, how we can minimize the flow velocity? We can provide another also this curtain which you call the seal fence or the curtain. It is nothing but a combination of post and the geotextile material, that whatever the suspended material will flow along this geosynthetic material. So, you have to minimize the flow velocity and what should be the maximum permissible fence height it should be. So, this is a kind of the layout of the seal fences. The main objective is to how slow down the downward velocity of the water on the slope and also at the same time removing as much as of the transported particle as is practicable. In fact, it acts as a kind of reservoir contaminated structure for a large portion of the precipitation at any given slope. So, total amount of the precipitation while need is to be retained at any particular period. So, whatever the precipitation blocked here, water can pass, then gradually you can see that how it can be reduced. So, for example, any construction site is there, road slope is there, and due to rain there is a possibility for the rain water can pass through this, and muddy water suspension material can pass through this, then this all the car may be the block, construction may be the block. So, you can provide this kind of the sill fences. So, this kind of the sill fence can protect. So, here you have to be select that what kind of the geosynthetic material you should be select, what should be the height of the post and what should be the depth of the post and what should be the spacing between the posts. So, it should fulfill the retention criteria as per FAW 1985, that is O95 is equal to D85 soil, that is for urban geotextile, O95 is equal to 1.8 D85 soil for non-urban geotextile material, and B flow capacity criteria, that is FAW 1985, that psi is equal to 10 into Q divided by AD, what psi is equal to permittivity of geosynthetics per second, Q run of flow rate, that is meter cube per minute, and AD is cross sectional area of the ditch, that is meter square, and 10 is the factor of the safety. Also, it should satisfy the C clogging criteria, that means gradient ratio test are to be conducted, and criteria for geosynthetics to be free from clogging if the gradient ratio less than equal to 3. We have already mentioned that how to perform the gradient ratio test. Now, how to install this system? Now, I will explain installation technique of sill fences. The wooden steel posts are generally placed at an interval of 30 centimeter to 300 centimeter in a row. This is the wooden or the steel post can be placed at a interval of 30 to 300 centimeter in a row. And this sill fence consists of geotextile placed vertically on the post to prevent the sediment, and this is the wooden or steel post, this is the trench. Now, form a trench of minimum size 15 centimeter deep and 15 centimeter wide. This is the trench which is 15 centimeter wide and 15 centimeter deep. Next, at least 15 centimeter geosynthetics should be buried in the trench. Anchor lower portion of the geosynthetics in the trench and backfill the trench with natural material. Here, you have to be buried it geosynthetics material. The backfill soil is compacted to provide good anchorage to the geosynthetics in the trench as well as prevent the flow under trenches. So, this backfill material provided and this is necessary for the anchoring. Next, height of the fence should not be more than 15 centimeters, so that post can prevent overturning of the fence under sediment loading. Attach reinforcement wall between the post along with the geosynthetics if required. So, you can see here that water is 100% suspended solid in any suppose hillside area or any slope due to the rainfall, and how the water and 100% suspended solid material is passing through the seal fence. This seal fence, which consists of the geotextile that is placed vertically on the post to prevent the sediment. So, this is the post, this is the geocentric material. Next, you can see that water and 30% suspended solid. And next, gradually you can see how it is decreasing, the water and the 10% suspension solid. And like this, you can see water with 2% suspended solid. So, people can work in this area by providing that proper kind of the seal fence. So, we should know that what is seal fence, how will you design the seal fence, what should be the depth of the post, and what should be the height of the post, and what should be the spacing of the post. So, this is seal fence, which is preventing the precipitation runoff under flow. So, you can see one of the seal fences here, how it is being precipitated. Now, you want to determine the height of the seal fence. It is required to design the seal fence properly. The height of the seal fence need to be evaluated based on the amount of the precipitation. So, this is a schematic of the seal fences per unit width in a slope as shown. So, this is H of maximum, this is L of sail, and this is depth, and this is the peg, and this is the slope, and this is the face, and this is all precipitation. So, this is the seal fence per unit width in a downward slope. So, let K be the precipitation rate in meters per square meter over a time period of T. So, you calculate what will be the volume to be handled per square meter, let us say V square meter. Hence, V square meter, you know that Q into T. Let the length of each cell between the two successive fences L cell meter, this is length between the two posts, this is L cell. So, volume to be handled per cell per meter width is V cell. So, therefore, V cell will be the Q into T. That means this V square meter Q into T into L cell. So, this will give you what will be the volume of the handle per cell per meter width. That means V square meter, this is V square meter QT into L cell. Now, considering this earlier figure here, so you can write that V cell will be equal to half L cell into H maximum. This is the precipitation. So, this is like a triangle, so it will be the half into H maximum into L cell, and H maximum what will be the height of the fence required. Therefore, V cell is equal to half into L cell into H maximum. Therefore, half into L cell into H maximum is equal to V square meter into L cell. That means, this will be equal to this. That means, this will be equal to this. Okay, this is the volume to be handled per cell meter, that means V square meter into L cell. This will be equal to that what should be the V cell here, half into L cell into H maximum. So, that was the area, and H is the height of the fence required. So, from that we can write half into L cell into H maximum is equal to V square meter into L cell, or H maximum will be equal to 2 into V square meter. Again, if the gradient slope is 1 is to n, for this its gradient slope is 1 is to n. For example, its gradient slope 1 is to n. So, L cell will be n into h maximum. So, V cell will be equal to half into L cell into h maximum, then half into n into h maximum into h maximum. That means n into h maximum square divided by 2. Hence, h maximum should be equal to 2 into V cell root of, because this is h max square, root of 2 into V cell divided by n. Or you can write h maximum should be greater than equal to this root 2 1.41 root of V cell divided by n. If the peg depth needed d, then d should be greater than equal to 3 of h maximum, which is ideally adopted. Now, we are giving one example. The slope has a gradient of 1 is to 6, that means n value is 6, and the volume to be handled per cell per meter width is 0.3 cubic meter. Determine the fence height as well as depth by which the peg is to be driven. So, we know the equation. The solution is fence height h maximum will be equal to 1.41 root V of cell divided by n. So, h maximum is equal to 1.41 and V cell is given 0.3 cubic meter. So, 0.3 and slope is n is 6. So, this is 6.3 by 0.6. So, h maximum will be equal to 0.315 meter. Now, minimum peg depth d is 3 into h maximum, 3 into h maximum is 0.315. So, d will be the 0.946 meter. So, this way we can calculate that what should be the h maximum and what should be the peg depth. Next, mechanism of drainage function. You know that when the water flow along the plane or in plane of the candidate geosynthetics is called transmittivity. The main function is the drainage, or which we call the transmittivity. We have already covered. So, we can just for your information sake, we are giving this equation theta required will be equal to q into L by delta h into w. This you know earlier already explained. Now, also we have also shown the slope representative of the transmittivity, that is also known to you. Now, geosynthetics used for in-plane drainage. So, different types of the material can be used. It may be woven monofilament, woven silk film, non-woven rigid bonded, non-woven heat bonded, non-woven needle punch, and hybrid drainage, geocomposite, and geonets. Now, what should be the design step for the drainage? First, step 1, determine the quantity of flow of water using flow net diagram. You know that Q is equal to K delta H N F by N D. This also we explained earlier, so you know that how to calculate the flow of water by flow net diagram. Step 2, you can determine the required transmittivity of the geosynthetic. So, earlier we discussed with the permittivity, now it is transmittivity of the geosynthetic. This equation also known, theta required into Kp into Tg is equal to QL by delta H into W. Step 3, you determine the ultimate transmittivity of the geosynthetic, what is from the laboratory. From the laboratory, you know how to determine the ultimate transmittivity, that is theta ultimate. Step 4, determine the allowable transmittivity. So, theta allowable will be equal to theta ultimate by cumulative reduction factor. This cumulative reduction factor, this may be reduction factor for soil clogging and blinding. This is reduction factor, RFCR is reduction factor for the creep reduction factor of void. This is RFIN, that is intrusion into the void. This reduction factor for intrusion into the void. And this is RFCC, this is reaction factor for chemical clogging, and RFBC is reduction factor for biological clogging. So all these factor, depending upon type of application, can be selected, and then you can calculate that what will be the cumulative reduction factor, and ultimately you can calculate it what will be the theta of allowable. Step 5, determine the factor of safety. So factor of safety will be equal to theta allowable by theta recall. If the factor of safety is not adequate, one can use more number of the geosynthetic material, alternatively geocomposite or geonet drain can be used. So in our permittivity problem, filtration problem, we can follow the steps 7 to 12 geosynthetic filter design, as those are the same criteria for geosynthetic drainage design. So application of geosynthetic drainage. Geosynthetic can perform the drainage function in earth dam, reservoir, retaining wall, embankment, ground improvement application, etc. Now first I am expressing the geosynthetics gravity drainage. If the water flow due to the difference in the hydraulic head, it is called the gravity drainage. Transmittivity of geosynthetic decreases with increasing the normal stresses. You know this, we have already discussed earlier. The geosynthetic can be placed both horizontally and vertically according to the field application. When the geosynthetic is placed vertically, the applied normal pressure of the geosynthetic, that means horizontal pressure at a certain depth, that horizontal pressure will be equal to the vertical stress into coefficient of earth pressure at rest, and that at rest k0 can be determined using the equation k0 is equal to 1 minus sin pi, that is 0.5 if pi is not provided, or pi is equal to angle of internal friction of the soil. You can see this is an earth dam geosynthetics as a gravity drain. Here the geosynthetics as a chimney drain, here geosynthetic drain as a gallery, and this is the clay core. And in the clay core, you can draw the flow net, and you can determine what should be the number of the flow lines and the equipotential line. And this angle also is known to you. Suppose here is 75 degree, this height of the dam is h, and this water level is about 12 meter. This is just showing one of the example like that. Similarly, geosynthetic gravity drains behind the retaining wall, what you can use. You can see this is the retaining wall, there is a whip hole, and geotextile material is placed just behind the retaining wall. So whatever water will flow, this will go vertically downwards and then passes through the whip hole. So here we will go for one design for this wall, its height may be the 9 meter, then what quantity of water flow through this, then that also it can be determined by drawing the flow net diagram. And from the flow net diagram, you can estimate that what will be the number of flow line, NF is equal to 5, what will be the number of potential line, ND also will be equal to the 5. Now one example that design the geotextile drainage. So this is a earth dam, and ultimate transmittivity of this geosynthetic material given 10 × 10⁻⁴ meter square per minute, and coefficient of permeability of the soil K is 1 × 10⁻⁶ meter per second, and cumulative reduction factor is 3. So in the core, this is clay core, so you can draw a flow net diagram, and this angle is 70 degree and this height is about 8 meter. So from the flow net diagram, you can calculate what is the number of flow 5, and because number of the potential line 2, so ND is equal to 2, NF is equal to 5, and this angle remember is 70 degree and height is 8 meter. Now solution, step 1, calculate the flow rate. So you draw the flow rate diagram, then you use the equation Q is equal to K delta H NF by ND, K value is given 1 × 10⁻⁶ meter per second, delta H is 8 meter, and then NF is equal to 5, ND is equal to 2, you have obtained from the Froden diagram. Then you substitute the value K is 1.10⁻⁶ into delta H is equal to 8, and NF by ND is equal to 5/2. So, Q will be equal to 20 × 10⁻⁶. This is the flow rate. Now, that means this Q is 20 × 10⁻⁶ meter square per second, and this will be 120 × 10⁻⁶ meter square per minute, and you can write 1.2 × 10⁴ meter square per minute. Now, step 2, calculate required transmittivity theta required. From the Darcy's law, we know theta required Kp into Tg, Q by I into W. Q is already you have calculated 1.2 × 10⁴ meter square per minute, and I is sin 70 degree is equal to 0.94, because this wall, this is core wall, this angle is 70 degree. So, this is I. So, I is equal to 70 degree is equal to 0.94, and W is equal to width of the geotextile is 1 meter. So, theta required will be Q. Q is equal to 1.2 × 10⁻⁴, this divided by I value is equal to 0.94, this is 0.94, and W is equal to 1. So, this theta required will be equal to 1.27 × 10⁻⁴ meter square per minute. Now, step 3, allowable transmittivity of geotextile, that is theta allowable. So, theta allowable will be theta ultimate by reduction factor. So, theta allowable, you know that theta ultimate value 10 × 10⁻⁴, and reduction factor is given 3. So, theta allowable will be equal to 3.3 × 10⁻⁴ meter square per minute. Step 4, determine the factor of safety. So, factor of safety is the ratio of theta allowable by theta required, and what is theta allowable? 3.3 × 10⁻⁴, and theta required we have calculated 1.27 × 10⁻⁴. This is theta required, 1.27 × 10⁻⁴. So, this is theta required is 1.27 × 10⁻⁴. So, we will have the factor of safety 2.62. So, as it is a critical structure, calculate the factor of safety is low. So, therefore, it is recommended that minimum factor of safety is 5. Then what we will do? So, we do some back calculation, assuming factor of safety is equal to 5. Allowable geotextile transmittivity theta allowable will be equal to 5 × theta required. That means 5 × theta required, you know, 1.27 × 10⁻⁴, that is equal to 6.35 × 10⁻⁴ meter square per minute. Now, considering cumulative reduction factor, that is 3. So, from the manufacturer side, theta ultimate is 6.35 × 10⁻⁴ into cumulative reduction factor 3 is 19.09 × 10⁻⁴ meter square per minute. Therefore, it is required very thick geotextile which is not economical. So, alternatively geonet or geocomposite can be considered. Now, this is another example. This is the backfill soil behind a cantilever retaining wall. A silty sand, and coefficient of permeability of the soil is 4 × 10⁻⁵ meter per second. Allowable transmittivity of geotextile theta allowable is given 0.2 × 10⁻³ meter square per minute. Height of the wall is 9 meter. So, here you can see that again you can draw the Froden diagram, you find out what is NF and ND, that is equal to the 5. Now, the solutions. Step 1, calculate the maximum flow rate coming to the geotextile from flow net, that is you know the equation Qk delta H NF by ND. K is equal to 4 × 10⁻⁵ meter per second, delta H 9 meter, NF is equal to 5, ND is equal to 5. So, Q will equal to K is 4 × 10⁻⁵ into delta H is 9, and NF by ND 5/5, you can have Q is equal to 36 × 10⁻⁵. So, this is meter square per second. So, this you can write again 36 into 10 to the power minus 5 into 60, that is meter square per minute, that is equal to 0.0216 meter square per minute. Now, step 2, determine the flow gradient within the geotextile. Here I is equal to delta H by L, that means it will be 1, and delta is equal to hydraulic head H is equal to 9 meter, L is equal to vertical length of the geotextile under water level is equal to 9 meter. Now, alternatively you can also write I is equal to sin 90 degree is equal to 1.0. Step 3, calculate the required transmittivity. Then theta required, you know, Kp into Tg Q by I into W, that means Q is known, that is 0.0216, which we have calculated 0.0216. So, this is 0.0216, I is equal to, you know, 1, W is equal to 1. So, theta required will be 0.0216 meter square per minute. Now, step 4, calculate the factor of safety. It is given theta allowable 0.0002 meter square per minute. So, factor of safety will be theta allowable by theta required. That means factor of safety will be equal to 0.0002 divided by 0.0216 is equal to 0.009. So, you can see factor of safety is very, very less, so not acceptable. So, in that case, you can adopt the GeoNet or geocompetent drainage material. Now, we will discuss geosynthetic pressure drainage. When water drains out from high pressure zone towards the low pressure zone irrespective of hydraulic head difference, it is called the pressure drainage. So, geosynthetic pressure drainage beneath an embankment. Here you can see that this is on embankment and geosynthetic is placed between the foundation soil and the embankment. So, embankment with geosynthetics as a pressure drain over, this is a soft saturated soil and this is the both side is the drainage. So, I will give you one of the example also how you can solve this problem geosynthetic for the pressure drainage. So, Giroud 1984 give this equation, that is theta required is equal to Kp into Tg is equal to B square Ks by Cb into T whole to the power half. This theta required is the geosynthetic transmittivity, Kp is equal to in plane coefficient of permeability of geotextile. This is Tg is the thickness of the geosynthetic material and B is the width of the surcharge. Ks is the coefficient of permeability of the foundation soil and Cb is equal to coefficient of vertical consolidation of foundation soil and T is time required for surcharge. So, you should remember this equation. So, let us one example, this is so that geosynthetic pressure drainage system beneath an embankment. This is the embankment and geosynthetic placed here and this is the B and this is the foundation soil, fine grain compressible soil. So, there is a development of the pressure on the geotextile material and this is the drain. You can see that how the water is passing along the plane of the geosynthetic material to the drainage. So, in this problem that surcharge field is placed within 15 days, that means 21600 minute over the foundation soil and coefficient of permeability soil is given 10 into 10 to the power minus 10 meters per second and coefficient of consolidation Cb is given is equal to 3 into 10 to the power minus 6 meter square per minute. Ultimate transmittivity of the geotextile is given, theta ultimate is equal to 0.65 10 to the power minus 3 meter square per minute. Let us consider cumulative reduction factor is equal to 4. You have to calculate what will be the maximum width of the surcharge field required geotextile transmittivity. We have to find out maximum width of the surcharge, this what will be the maximum width of the surcharge. So, this is an example of geosynthetic pressure drainage beneath an embankment. Now, the solution, step 1, you calculate theta required in terms of B. So, we know that according to the Giroud 1981, theta required is equal to B square Ks divided by Cb into T whole to the power half. Ks is given is 10 into 10 to the power minus 10 meter per second. That means 10 into 10 to the power minus 10 into 60 meter per minute. And B is the width of the surcharge. And CB coefficient of consolidation also given, 3 into 10 to the power minus 6 meter square per minute. And time T for surcharge field, it is for 15 days. That means 21600 minute. So now theta required, we can write B square into Ks. Ks is this, 10 into 10 to the power minus 10 into 60. This divided by CB. CB is equal to 3 into 10 to the power minus 6 into capital T, that is equal to this. That means this you can write 0.0216 into 10 to the power 6, and this whole to the power half. So if you calculate this, you can have a relationship between theta required and B square. So theta required will be equal to 2.357 10 to the power minus 7 B square. So now you have to plot the theta required versus B. That will be the surface base width in meter. So you assume the different values of B, and then you calculate what will be the theta required. So here you are assuming the different value 5, 10, 20, 30, 40, 60 meter width of the surcharge base width. And then accordingly you can calculate the what will be the theta required. Because you know this equation, theta required is equal to in terms of B square. So knowing, assuming the different values of B, so you can calculate theta required and you can draw a curve like this. So from this curve, step 3, that calculate theta required B maximum, you can obtain that theta of ultimate value given is 0.65 into 10 to the power minus 3 meter square per minute. It is given, and considering the reduction factor is equal to 4, so theta allowable is equal to theta ultimate divided by reduction factor. That means theta allowable will be equal to 0.65 10 to the power minus 3 divided by 4 is equal to 0.000162 meter square per minute. Let the global factor safety 2, so theta required will be equal to 0.0001625 divided by 2 is equal to 0.0000825 meter cube per minute per meter. So from the theta required and B curve, what I have shown in the step 2, so you can calculate what will be the B maximum. That will come B maximum 18.566 meter. So you know that what will be the theta required. So you know this value. So you can draw horizontally and then vertically downward, you can see, you can have what should be the B, what will be the surcharge base width in meter. So it is less than in between 10 to 20, this is 18 point something, this is 18.566 meter. So this we have calculated what is B maximum. Next, the capillary migration wake. You can see that most of the time in the roadway, you can see it is a clay soil and this water level is here, and there is an upward flow of capillary water. Something of water can move beyond the roadway, and water is stagnant, that is due to the upward flow of the capillary water. So what we do in general, we provide with the drainage somewhere here. So if you can provide with the drainage, some conventional system drainage we can provide here, and because this upward flow of capillary water is more, then it will be very difficult to control the flow with the conventional system. Therefore, it is required to provide a geosynthetic material and then under drainage from both the side, and then you can provide with the some slope, that is 8% slope. So whatever the water or capillary or pass through the geotextile material, it should be going down to the drainage. Even then some water what is come from the top from the rainfall, that also can pass through this slope and then to the drainage. So this is one of the very important that capillary migration break kind of the problem, and how you can solve the problem using geocentric material. Here I am giving one simple example. Check the suitability of the geotextile capillary migration break under a roadway. So properties of the geotextile is given. Let us say allowable transmittivity of the geotextile theta allowable is equal to 0.0005 meter square per minute. Under a 50 kilopascal vertical pressure, width of the geotextile W is equal to 1 meter and reduction factor is equal to 3. Now the same, I say the capillary migration break using geotextile under roadway, and first of all that step 1, you have to calculate the upward flow water of groundwater in the locality. So you should know what will be the upward flow of water in this locality. So to calculate the upward flow of groundwater in the locality, you have to conduct the unconfined aquifer fill permeability test. You know that what is unconfined aquifer fill permeability test, and from this test you can calculate that what will be the upward flow rate of groundwater. Let from this fill permeability test you calculate that Q is equal to 2.5 into 10 to the power minus 5 meter cube per minute. So in that locality you should know what will be the flow rate of that water. So that is very important. Whatever when you design for the filtration and the drainage for any road, etc. So you should know that what will be the quantity of water flow in that area. You should know what will be the intensity of the rainfall in that area. Most of the time design has not made as far the quantity of water flow in that locality. So one has to be very careful for the design of geosynthetic material for the filtration and drainage. So you should know exactly that what is the quantity of water flow in the locality, and accordingly you can design for the filtration and the drainage for the geotextile material. Now step 2, determine the gradient of flow in the geotextile. Here it is given the 8% slope, that is equal to 0.08 gradient. Step 3, required transmittivity, that is theta required. Theta required will be Q by IW, and Q is equal to flow rate, which we calculated here, Q 2.5 into 10 to the power minus 5 meter cube per minute. So you write Q is equal to 2.5 10 to the minus meter cube per minute, and I is equal to, this is slope 0.08, and W is equal to width of the geotextile 1 meter. So if you substitute this value, so he can determine theta required is equal to 2.5 into 10 to the power minus 5 Q divided by I is 0.08 and W is equal to 1 meter. So this theta required 31.25 into 10 to the power minus 5, that means is equal to 0.0003 meter square per minute. Step 4, calculate the global factor of safety. That means factor of safety is equal to theta allowable by theta required. So factor of safety, you know what is theta allowable, 0.0005, and this divided by theta required 0.00031, which we know earlier what is theta required. Okay. So you can calculate the factor of safety, this is 1.61. So factor of safety is equal to 1.6 on the lower side, it is less than 3, so it is not okay. So therefore you have to select some alternative material. Either you can select the geo net or you can select the geo composite material. So you can see most of the cases, if you do not select that proper kind of the geosynthetic material and how it is not satisfying all the criteria. It is not satisfying the factor of safety, it is not satisfying the flow criteria, it is not satisfying the permittivity or the transmittivity criteria. Next, design of drainage with the GeoNet. So let us discuss that design of drainage with GeoNet. There are mainly two type of the GeoNet. That is, one is the biplanar GeoNet and another is the triplanar GeoNet. So you can see this is a kind of the biplanar GeoNet material. You can see this is rhombus in shape, and if there is any flow quantities more, then you can use the biplanar GeoNet material. Or if the quantity of flow more and more, then you can use triplanar GeoNet. So mass per unit area of this kind of the GeoNet varies from 500 to 2000 gram per meter square. So we observe that what is the type of the biplanar GeoNet and what is the type of the triplanar GeoNet. Now, concept of drainage with GeoNet, very simple. The primary function of GeoNet is flow rate. It is preferable to design with the flow rate rather than transmittivity because of non-laminar flow condition in GeoNet. So it will not obey the Darcy's law. So therefore, when we will design, then you should think about whether it is a laminar flow or the non-laminar flow. If it is a non-laminar flow, then you are to consider that what should be the quantity of flow of water passes through that area. So here, factor of safety can be determined by Q allowable, which you can determine from the laboratory test, and Q required, what is the design value, and that factor of safety should be greater than or equal to 3. And Q allowable is equal to Q ultimate by cumulative reduction factor. You know what is cumulative reduction factor, and then you have to calculate the what will be the factor of safety, that is theta allowable by theta required. But theta allowable by theta required not preferable because of non-laminar flow condition. So we have to deal with the flow related problem, flow, not the theta allowable and theta required. This is geocomposite drainage. So GeoNet can be sandwiched between two geotextiles from one or both sides, and is called the geocomposite drainage. For example, this is the GeoNet, and you can see this is also laminated with the geotextile material, non-wet geotextile material. So this is on the one side, and also you can have, this is GeoNet inside, you can have both the side, this top and this is also the bottom. It is like a sandwich between the two geotextile from one or both side, is called the geocomposite drain. So you know that what is geocomposite drain. And landfill cover, this is GeoNet are exclusively being used in the landfill project around the world, mainly for leachate collection and removal system. So here geocomposite drainage system is shown in a landfill cover on the top. This is the landfill and this is the all waste material, and on the top of that you are to provide with the geocomposite material, that is GeoNet, and then laminated with geotextile material. Its top and bottom is geotextile and this is GeoNet material. So this is a geocomposite material is been covered. This is the covered soil. So you need to design this covered soil. Most of the cases you can see in India, lot of landfill it is now opening, there is no cover. So you have to provide proper kind of the covering system. So this you have to provide with the geomembrane material, which is impermeable material, and then you can provide with the geocomposite material. This is geonet and geotextile at the top and the bottom, and then you fill up with the covered soil with a certain slope of 8%, and on the top of the soil you can provide the topsoil, and then here you can grass can grow. The whole thing looks like a very greenery, and this height of the covered soil is designated here at H, and the whatever water, though it is an impermeable material, if water can percolate, most of the time there is a possibility for cracking, then rain water can pass through this and then pass through this geotextile material and then pass to the drainage. So then waste material will not be, no formation of the leachate. So you have to protect the waste material by providing the geomembrane and geocomposite material. Now you will design this covered soil. This height is equal to the H. So for an example, in a landfill liner cover, geocomposite, I say geomembrane, it means geonet and geotextile material is used in a slope with the 8% gradient. Here is the 8% gradient, and then height of the covered soil 2.5 meter. This is height of the H is 2.5 meter, and density of the fill, this is density of the fill, is 15 kilonewton per meter. This is density of the fill, this is 15 kilonewton per meter, and required flow rate, that is Q required, is 0.18 into 10 to the power minus 4 meter cube per second. So ultimate flow rate to the geocomposite from in plane test, that is Q ultimate, is 3.5 into 10 to the power minus 4 meter cube per second at a hydraulic gradient of 0.08. So under this hydraulic, you know that water can just pass through along the plane of geosynthetic, that is why it is transmittivity, and then it goes to the drainage, and this is the height and this is the density. So you will be knowing what will be the stress here, that vertical stress here acting on this geocomposite material. So you can determine what will be the flow rate through the geocomposite from in plane test. Let us say Q ultimate value, you obtain 3.5 into 10 to the power minus 4 meter cube per second at a hydraulic gradient 0.08. Now this is under a normal pressure, that is sigma n is equal to 2.5 into 15. So this is the 2.5 is the height of the covered soil, that is meter, 2.5, that height of the covered soil, and density of the fill is 15 kilonewton per meter cube. This is gamma into H, that means this is gamma and this is H. So H is equal to 2.5 and gamma, density of the fill, is 15 kilonewton per meter. So this is the normal pressure sigma n will be the 2.5 into 15 is equal to 37.5 kilopascal, and cumulative reduction factor consider 4. So now the solution. Now step 1, E required flow rate is provided, that means Q required is 0.1 into 10 to the power minus 4 meter cube per second. Step 2, you ultimate flow rate through the geocomposite drain as determined in the laboratory is given, that Q ultimate is equal to, that is 3.5 10 to the power minus 4 meter cube per second for I is equal to 0.8 under a normal pressure sigma n is equal to 37.5 kilopascal, simulating the actual fill condition. Step 3, calculate the allowable flow rate, Q allowable, through the geocomposite drain. So Q allowable will be Q ultimate by reduction factor. Q ultimate is 3.5 into 10 to the power minus 4. So Q ultimate 3.5 into 10 to the power minus 4. This reduction factor is 4. So Q allowable will be 0.88 into 10 to the power minus 4 meter cube per second. Step 4, calculate the factor of safety. So factor of safety is equal to Q allowable by Q required. So factor of safety will be equal to 0.88 into 10 to the power minus 4. This divided by, this is Q allowable, 0.8 into the power minus 4 this divided by Q required. Q required we have calculated earlier, 0.1 into 10 to the power minus 4. So this also we have calculated earlier, okay. This is Q required is 0.18 into 10 to the power minus 4 meter cube per second. So this is Q required is 0.18 into 10 to the power minus 4. So this will give you the factor of safety 4.89. So factor of safety is equal to 4.89, it is greater than 3, so it is more than equal, so it satisfies the criteria. So here you see that how that geocomposite material have been used, and it is the design is based on the flow related. So you remember when it is not in the laminar flow condition, then you are to design based on the flow. So you can check that what will be the flow related problem, and you find now this material is suitable for the landfill cover system. So then there will be no problem, you can protect the landfill from the leakage or contamination problem. So you have to be careful for the select the material. So we deal with the open geotextile material, non-open geotextile material. You can see sometimes it does not satisfy the criteria. If it sometimes does not satisfy the criteria, we go for the more number of the layer of the geotextile material. Either it is an open geotextile material or it is a non-open geotextile material. If you go more number of geotextile material, then you will be knowing that it is thick. It will be gradually thicker and thicker, it will be quite expensive. So alternative to that, you can adopt the geocomposite material, you can adopt the geonail material, you can adopt the combination of the geonet and the non-open geotextile material. It is in a laminated form on the one side or on the both side, or you can use like a triangular type of the geonet material. So this kind of the material can satisfy this criteria. Of course there are many different types of the geocomposite product are coming up, which will be very much useful for the related with the drainage and the filtration problem. Because most of the time that structure fell due to the drainage and the filtration. So you have to be careful for the proper selection of the geosynthetic material. With this I ended up this lecture. Thank you.